everyone, big warm welcome from me, Carol here at Oak House Journals, and I just thought I would quickly nip on to YouTube and do a quick video of the tags, or four of the tags that I'm making for what was the Oak House Journal tag swap. So what gave me my inspiration was this little bit of packaging that was left over. As you can see, we got some llama bed socks recently. These are obviously meant for winter, but it was this bit of packaging that gave me my inspiration, and particularly the fact that it had a hole cut into it. So I am going to use this, and I will be recreating another three of these, because all four of these tags will be identical, but I will show you the process. And this was also part of the packaging, Barley Lane by Totes, and I thought this would make quite a nice little tuck spot in there. It's not sealed or anything at the moment. So these two pieces gave me my inspiration. I will certainly be using the one with the circle in. Whether I use this or not, I don't know, but if I don't use it on this project, then I will certainly use it on another. So I've also cut out from some packaging four tag bases. These are roughly, I think, 7 inches by, let me just measure these for you. They're smaller than normal tags, so 2¾ wide by 5, and just over 5½. So in centimetres, 7 centimetres by 14. So that is going to be the size of my tags. So I've got four of those. Then what I've done is I've taken some more of that old shirt, that linen shirt that I love, done some more dyeing on it with some paints. I will put the link in the description box down below to the video which actually discusses what the paints are and how I did it. But what I've done is I've cut out, or I've ripped and painted, four pieces of fabric. As you can see, there's two. That's my third piece, and that's my fourth piece. And I've also cut out some just very thin wadding. So what I'm planning to do now is I'm just going to turn the fabric over. The wadding is the same size as my card. My fabric is slightly bigger. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn a hem all the way round in my fabric, and I'm going to tack very, very lightly all the way around the edge. And that will give me, whoops-a-daisy, that's just catching. That will give me my base for starting to create my embroidery. Now, I don't have to pad these, but I just wanted a little bit of springiness. I didn't want to back them, or the back the fabric straight onto the card. I wanted it to have a slightly quilted finish to it. So that's what I'm going to do, and I will be back in due course when I've done that and tacked all the way around and started to do some sewing. All right, see you in a little while. So this is what my four pieces of fabric look like now. I've just clipped them for ease to the piece of card that is going to form the backing. The fabric has been folded round the padding, and all I've done is a very, very rough couple of lines of tacking stitch all the way around, just to hold that edging in place and to hold my padding in place as well. So these are now ready for me to go away and stitch. So, because the prompt for the June tag swap was ocean, a die cut and vellum, obviously you'll have guessed when you saw this piece of packaging that I plan to make a window of some sort. Well, I'm actually going to make a pocket, and these are the tags that are going to go into the pocket. So I'm going to put not vellum. As I said, you can use vellum, you can use acetate, you can not use anything at all. The prompts are there just for you to use if you want to, or kick out if you don't want to. So I'm not actually going to be using vellum, but I am going to be using acetate, and I'm going to create a window, or actually a porthole. That's my cunning plan. And because it was ocean themed, I'm going to do a little ocean embroidery on here, or a sea themed embroidery on each one of these, and they probably will all be exactly the same because I've got quite a few to get out. So what I've done is I have made some little Suffolk puffs out of the same fabric. I can just get my little bag open, and these were circles that were an inch across when I started them, so they are very small now. I haven't made them so that they are perfect on the reverse, because I don't necessarily need them to be perfect. So I'm going to put a little arrangement of a few, or one, or none maybe, of these on the bottom of my tags. I have also lifted out some sea charms that I might use. I have also lifted out some various coloured seed beads, different sizes. So these two are very aqua tones, so they will work well. I've got some little white ones here. I've got some little pearly ones there, and I've got some tiny, tiny white ones. So I will be using those. I also have some clear sequins, and I might be using those for bubbles. I don't know, we'll see. I certainly have lifted out some of my threads. So I'm going to go away now and get on with that, and I'll be back shortly. So these are my finished pieces, or finished as far as the embroidery side of things go. As you can see, they're still attached just with a paper clip to the backing card that I'm going to use. They're all very much a much of a muchness, I'm afraid, in terms of how they look. Slight variations, but I've been away this week. I wanted to take just a minimal sewing kit with me, and just get into the zone and enjoy the pure pleasure of just sewing. So I've had a lovely time this week creating these. So just very quickly to run through, this one's, as I say, there are very slight variations. This one's got a piece of chiffon, as well as the bullion tendrils. I've done drizzle stitch on this one and couched it down. There's a little shell here. This one, just fly stitch and what's the other one? Fly stitch and feather stitch, sorry, can never remember. And then I've done some whipped stem stitch at the bottom here in a slightly different colour to pick up sort of a little bit of purple on this one. There's bullion circles, French knots, always French knots. This one's the same. There's a few little sequins on all of them. There's sequins to try and replicate bubbles. And I've put tiny, tiny little glass seed beads dotted in amongst all the wraps and knots and things down at the bottom. This one's got some tiny, tiny single strand, bullion circles. You saw me put on the Suffolk puffs. Sometimes I've used them with the smooth side up, so the gathered side is pointing down. And sometimes, like here, I've left the gathered side uppermost and put a little bit of fibre in them just to add some interest. And I think you've seen this one. Again, I've put in one of my little charms. They have a hole, just a single hole, and this one I've kind of erupted bullion knots through it, but it's quite loose apart from that. But I've put the bullion tendrils, I've tried to wrap it round to make a little snug housing for it. Again, I've done a kind of fibre inside the Suffolk puff, some tiny, tiny little circles there, bullion circles. And then on this one, I haven't quite got the spacing right with the bullion tendril between that and this erupting Suffolk puff again. I have stitched it down, but as you can see, it's not sitting nicely. So I might cheat on that one and put a little bit of glue. So that's where I've got so far. Now what I need to do is go away, obviously, and attach them to the backing and do what decoration I have in mind for the back. But before I do that, I was asked by a lovely lady called Anita if I would just show how I do the bullion tendrils and the drizzle stitches. Now, there are loads and loads of videos out there on YouTube showing how to do this. This is just how I do it. So if you're not interested in this, this is a great opportunity to fast forward or go and get a cup of tea. Many of you will have seen that I have what I call my reminder hoop. And as you can see on here, I've done some of the stitches. These are cast on drizzle stitches. And I'll show you how to do those. And these are some bullion tendrils. Those of you that were interested and asked for the video, and there was one lady in particular that asked where I'd got this Elizabethan moss stitch, as I call it, from, I found the link for the video that I was watching, and I will put that in the description box down below underneath this video. Okay, so I've got a new piece of fabric in my little hoop here. Nothing special, just cotton fabric, and this is going to be a new reminder hoop for me. Couple of quick things. You do not need these by any means, but they will make your life so much easier. And what they are bullion needles. Now I bought a tube of three of these. They're tulip needles, and I got them from Amazon. Now these are the medium size. I've got a little twig in there, which I'm trying to keep safe. These are medium size. They're about 2.5 inches, which is 6 centimetres. And these are brilliant because, for the simple reason that you are going to be putting on or casting on so many stitches onto your needle that you really do need a long one. Now, I find that a medium one is absolutely fine for me. For the number of stitches that I usually cast on. I don't mind if it comes off the bottom, and I'll show you, there is a knack. This will all become clear in a minute. Sorry if I'm confusing you. There is a little bit of a knack if your stitches start coming off the end, so don't worry about that. Another good pointer I found, you can use most threads for these. What I have used on here are these. Now these are Rayon threads, and these are a couple of the Sue Spargos. Now as you can see, this is the blue one that I've been using on all of these, and as I say, it's Rayon. This is RZMO5 and this is RZMO6 in terms of colour. So as you can see, one's variegated blue, the other one's a variegated green. Now, I have found these amazing to do drizzle stitches and bullion knots with. But you can use anything. As you can see on here, I've used cottons. This is perlay cotton. So you can use anything, really. But if you're just starting out and you want to try something that will work absolutely every time, then try these. Okay, and again, link in the description box down below. So you want a fair amount of thread on your needle. So what I tend to do is I measure out an arm's length. So I hold the end of my thread in my finger. I hold my spool of thread in the other hand, and I just stretch it out all the way along my arm up to my shoulder, and it gives me a piece of thread that is about, let me just, for me, it's about 60 centimeters long. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a quilter's knot in the end. I like to do 3 wrap quilter's knots. Okay, so there's my quilter's knot at the end. Now, what I also like to do is get my tail thread quite short. Not amazingly short, but about 6 inches. Okay, so this is for the cast-on drizzle stitch first off. So come through from the wrong side to the front. Then take your needle and put it down. Now I put it back through the fabric as close as I can. I'll show you there, close as I can to where I came up. And what I'm going to do is I'm pushing it down. And then what I'm doing is I'm unthreading that needle. So it's poked down through my frame, sticking out the other side. Be careful to miss your knot if you can. Please don't go through your knot, because that will make life very difficult for you. So there's my needle poking up. There's my hole there. My point is down below. Get your thread. And all I tend to do is I pick it up, put it over my index finger, like so. Hold the rest across my hand. And just turn it. I hope you can see this. I'm just holding it in my hand over my index finger, and I'm just turning it. Now what's happening there, if I flip it over, you can see that the threads are crossing. I just take that loop and put it on my needle and pull it gently down to the bottom. Now I'm not pulling that tight, I'm just letting it go snug at the bottom. So let me do that again. So over my finger, cross it over, and then I'm putting my needle, if I show you, I'm putting my needle through that twist. Now some people, you could do it this way. I've taken my finger out completely. I've just crossed it over like that with this thread, the long thread, coming over the top, and you could just flip it over like that and put it on. That might be easier for you to see and get the idea. So let's do that again, over my finger, crossing it over. I'm just catching that point where the two threads cross, like so, and dropping that down over my needle. So again, making that flip over, like so, and dropping it over my needle. Now, and it's dropped over my needle, and I'm just tightening it up with this hand here. Now, as you get going, as you get used to doing this, you cannot even make that cross. You can just kind of get used to flipping it easily. So I'm just doing a few more. I'm trying to push my needle to one side so you can see what I'm doing. like so. All you need to do is carry on working like that, looping your stitches onto your needle. What you'll find is that they will automatically start rotating around your needle as you go, and you can increase that rotation. Let me show you on this piece. So as you can see here, they are rotating as they go. Now you can increase that rotation just by giving it a little twist at the end, but as you're working, you'll find that the stitches will start spiraling up your needle, and you may find that you need to just take your thread round the back and carry on working. It just makes it a little bit easier for you. All I'm doing here is I'm just supporting the needle with one hand, and I'm just keeping a finger on the top as well. And as I work closer to the top, you'll find me putting my finger on the top. And the reason I do that is just to stop the stitches popping off the end of the needle, because you're going to want to put on here a good 30, 40, 50, even more cast-ons. See, I'm taking my thread round the back just to help with the lying of the threads. And as I was saying, sorry, you're going to be putting on a lot of stitches on your needle. So really, how many stitches you put on is entirely up to you. I usually end up putting a good 50, 60, 70 on, because I quite like long drizzle stitches. So I just carry on working like this. What you're doing as you're working as well is you're just butting up your stitches one against the other, not so that you're working tightly all the way along. You're just really keeping a nice comfy tension, not tight, but I would say reasonably taut. You don't want loops like this. You want to pull your thread so that it works its way down to the next stitch. If you do that, then if you are familiar with tatting, you're going to end up with a loop or a picot, which won't stop your tendril from working, your drizzle stitch from working, but it won't give you the look that you are particularly after. So what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to work up to the eye of my needle. Now, my thread is beginning, as you can see, to unravel. This rayon thread is three-stranded. So what you want to be careful if you're working with this thread, or even with any other stranded thread, is that you make sure that you don't split your thread over the needle, that you're actually wrapping the whole of your thread around your needle. So I think I've got enough stitches on here. So what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to take my end and thread it back through my needle. Gone through? Yeah, there we go. Keeping my tail fairly small, my tail end fairly small. So that's what it looks like threaded up. And as you can see, my stitches have rotated on the needle. Now you can increase that rotation by just twirling the stitches on your needle. So there's your needle coming through on the reverse side. And all you do now is push your needle through the fabric. Now I tend to support my fabric on the reverse side, and just allow your stitches to come up the needle as you push it through the fabric. So just push your needle through and ease your stitches up the needle. So I'm doing this very, very slowly, very gently. And my stitches are beginning to come off the end of my needle. Can you see here? So I'm just allowing them to come off. just very gently. You can do this a lot quicker, everybody, but I'm just doing this nice and slowly for you. So there's the end of my needle there. These are my stitches off the end of the needle, and I'm just poking my needle through. Now, I'm almost through. So there's my needle out of the bottom of my stitches, and I'm just going to carry on taking it down through the fabric and pulling gently. Now, all you need to do here is just make sure that your loop of thread doesn't tangle up. So just watch what you're doing as you go, but gently pull your thread through your stitches, and you can help it through with your other hand if you want. And trust me, I'm trying to do this super slow so you can see what's happening. My thread's going through my stitches, and there we go. Now, you can leave your thread as loose as you want and not take up any more tension with this thread that's coming through your piece of fabric. If you want to shorten this, you just carry on pulling and it will tighten up your stitches like so. And I can't pull any more now, and this is rigid, so it will stand up on your work like that. Or you can slacken this off and just allow it to get to the length that it wants to get so that it just flops. So you do a little back stitch on the back of your fabric, or if you prefer doing knots, do a knot. And that's your drizzle stitch. And then for my pieces like this, I would just kind of manipulate it up my piece. You could have it straight up your piece, or you can curl it round, or whatever you want to do, couch it in place. Or the other thing is, you can actually cut the knot on the reverse side or leave a longer tail and create dangles with them, like so. I can tighten it up, same as before, by pulling my longer thread. This was my knotted end, so I can tighten it up, or I could just loosen it off a little bit and have it loose. So you could make kind of page dangles with them if you wanted to, like so, and have them hanging down. Or what I sometimes do is just open them all out completely. So there's my two ends. Just opened it out completely, drop it down onto a piece of work, and I could couch that down and have that like so on a piece of work. And that just gives you another option or another variation. Okay, let me show you now how to do bullion tendrils. Really easy, same sort of thing. So do a quilter's knot or some sort of knot or backstitch to secure your thread on the reverse. Come through to the front side of your fabric with your needle. Pull your thread through. Now what you want to do is take a really small bite of fabric to one side of your thread where it's come up through the fabric. Pull your needle through, but not all the way through. As you can see, I've left a little bit there. Okay. Get a small tail and just secure it with your thumb. Okay, so I've got this loop of thread here, and I like to just hold on to the needle so that I don't pull it all the way through my fabric. And then all you do is you just wrap counterclockwise round your needle. Now you want to just push your threads down to the base of your needle where it meets the fabric. Carry on winding, and every so often just pull your threads back down to the bottom And again, you're not working tight, you're just working a nice comfortable tension. Okay, and again, just going to push those threads down. Keep on winding. Now, when I do these, I do at least 100 wraps, maybe 120, 125. So I will keep on doing the counterclockwise wraps around my needle and pushing them down so that they're like so on my needle. And as you can see, I haven't been counting, but I'm nowhere near at 100 wraps here. But I'm getting to the top of my needle. So this is where the knack is. You want to keep a firm tension on here, on the wrap, on the thread that you're wrapping around your needle, and pinch it at the top. At the bottom here, now I know by doing this pinch, I know that this isn't going to unravel on me, because it's not like the cast on stitches. They will stay in place, but these won't. These will spring off your needle. As you can see, I've hardly got any needle at all there. It's almost through my fabric. Now, because I need to carry on wrapping on my needle and I haven't got much space left, still hanging on to that, what I'm doing is I'm pulling my needle through my fabric. Now, did you hear that little pop? The end of my needle is just there. That's where my eye is. And these are my threads going through the eye of the needle. So that is through the fabric. Now I'm just going to rest it there and carry on wrapping. Now you don't want to pull it too much. You want to keep it in contact as best you can with your fabric as you carry on wrapping. Now again, as you can see, I've got to the end of my needle. I've got no more room to push my threads down. So again, I'm just pinching that top and I'm just pushing my threads further down my needle, and I'm just lifting my needle a fraction away from the fabric. So if I hold that up, you can probably see that's where the end of my needle is. That's where my fabric is. So I've got about a centimeter there away from my fabric. Now, if you need more space on your needle, just keep on pushing those threads down. And they're going off my needle end here onto the thread that is between my fabric and my needle. But I've kept the wraps all nice and firm all the way up. And that is the knack. Keep that wrap nice and firm, not absolutely tight, just firm. Now I'm going to carry on wrapping here. I'm supporting the lower half of the needle with these fingers. And as you can see, my needle is now here. So I've got quite a distance here of thread that my stitches are now moving down onto. So I'm going to carry on. And as you can see, I'm just using my index finger of my left hand to push those stitches down. Now I still have a loop here. You can put as many wraps on your needle as you want to create whatever size of bullion tendril you want. I'm going to use up all of this thread. So I'm just going to very gently move some more stitches down. Create some more space at the top of my needle. And keep wrapping. Now this thread is brilliant for doing this. I haven't, this is going to be famous last words, I haven't had one of these go wrong at all using this thread. But I think it's really the technique more than anything. So my needle is now here. And I've got at least an inch and a quarter of wrapped thread here. So again, I've run out of needle space. So I'm just moving my stitches down, or my wraps down, I should say. Try not to let them bunch here too much, because they will have a tendency, if you don't give them enough thread, they will bunch. try and keep it fairly consistent. As you can see, I've got a little section there where they're bunching, so I'm not going to push any more thread onto any more wraps onto that thread. So I think I've got enough here. I'm getting to a stage where I can't work with this. Now, if you were putting less wraps onto your needle, you would have more spare thread here, but I haven't. So I'm going to make life easy for myself and stop now. So all to finish off your stitch, it's exactly what you've been doing. You literally just pull through, pull your needle up, and just ease those stitches off the needle as you pull your needle through your wraps. Okay, just very gently do that. And what you want to guard against is this piece here not unraveling. So I'm keeping the tension on that bit just by holding it with my finger there. Okay, I'm just easing my stitches, or my wraps, sorry. And as you can see, my needle is coming through. I'm going to just hold this thread and try and show you, like so. So I'm just going to carry on pulling, pulling, and pulling, and pulling. Okay. Now, as you can see, my needle is completely out of those wraps. And what you want to do is carry on pulling and use up this spare piece of thread by pulling it through. So just keeping that pinch on that last wrap, I'm just closing, just hanging onto it and closing up that stitch. And that is the bullion tendril. Now you can just pull it gently and you'll get lovely little wraps like that. And then go through to the other side, or the reverse side. And finish off as you want. So you can either do a little back stitch. Or a little knot. There we go. So there we have our two stitches. So we have our cast on drizzle stitch and our bullion tendril. And it's just the same. These are longer wraps. This one is a tight one with not so many wraps. And you can just manipulate them as you want and just couch them down. Again, you can manipulate them into a circle if you want, or really do whatever you want with them, leave them dangling. Anyway, I hope that was useful. I'm now going to go away and I am going to finish off the back of these cards. All right, see you in a bit. These are my four tags, all finished, done and dusted. And what I've done with them is I've made little pockets for the tags to fit in. As you can see, I've added charms and some of the drizzle stitches as dangles down the side. as you can see, I've made these little pockets. I've used a technique on the paper that I was told about by my lovely friend Jeff. Hi, Jeff. You add paint, acrylic paint, to dishwasher soap or washing up liquid, as we call it here, or dish soap, as I think it's called in America. And by mixing it up and blowing bubbles, it picks up the paint, and then you just dab your paper on it and it gives you this lovely, lovely speckled, bubbly type effect. So I've used that to cover my cardboard. I've stitched all the way round, just a very, very basic pocket. And then here, as you saw, this is my die cut. I tried to do it so that it would look a bit like a porthole, but it doesn't really, but that was my attempt. I've just put some little brads in there, double layered it, put some printed vellum behind, as you can see from my fingers there. It's semi-transparent. I was hoping it would be lighter than that and it would pick up the image on the back of, or from the tag behind, but that hasn't quite worked. So that's one of my tags. You'll have noticed I've got a little flap at the back here. I'm going to write on here June Tag Swap, Oak House Journals, and then I'm going to just pop a little business card in there. But this can go in a journal or something like that, and the business card can go elsewhere. So that's one of my tags. This is another one, and as you can see, still flap on the back. And this one is like that with a little turtle charm on the side. So I think somebody I know very well will know which tag she's getting. So that's the other one. Then there is this one, again with a blue clamshell type charm and some drizzle stitches. Whoops-a-daisy, that's the pocket for this one. And this is my last one. This one's a little bit tight. Come on, there we go. And this one's got a lovely shell on it as well. And those are my tags. I've hit the vellum prompt, I think, because I've used it for my windows. I've also put a little pocket on the back of each of my cards or my tags with another little tag with a ocean scene on it, and that's in a little vellum pocket. I've got ocean embroidery, and die cut is on the front here. So there we go, everybody. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoy seeing the process that I went through to pull these little tags together, and they're just very simple pockets, as you can see. I certainly had great fun making them. It took me a bit longer than I actually thought it would do to make them. It's probably taken me over a week, what with the embroidery and then doing the final bits and bobs today. But as always, lovely to do, fun to make. So thank you so much for watching, everybody. Take care. Bye-bye now.